knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
We just learned about vasoconstrictors, which increase blood pressure by constricting the blood vessels. Now let's learn about the precise opposite function, vasodilation, which is useful for lowering blood pressure. High blood pressure, or hypertension, is a major risk factor for ischemic heart disease, stroke, and renal impairment, among many other adverse clinical outcomes. It is extremely common, with millions of new cases observed each year. The risk factors for hypertension include older age, smoking, obesity, inactivity, as well as some genetic components. Generally, stage 1 hypertension can be defined by blood pressure higher than 130 millimeters mercury systolic or 80 millimeters mercury diastolic pressure, those referring to the pressure in the arteries during a heartbeat and in between heartbeats, respectively. Stage 2 hypertension is defined by blood pressure above 140 millimeters mercury systolic and 90 millimeters mercury diastolic. Blood pressure above 180 over 120 is considered a medical emergency and must be treated immediately due to the likelihood of severe health consequences of ischemic heart disease or stroke, which can be acutely life-threatening. Increased risk of heart disease caused by hypertension is due to the narrowing of blood vessels inside the heart. Reduced luminal space increases vascular resistance and increases the amount of work the heart must exert to overcome the increased resistance and keep the blood circulating. When the heart is unable to compensate for this increased resistance by increasing cardiac contractility, this causes angina or severe chest pain, usually due to oxygenation insufficiency, and can lead to congestive heart failure. Vasodilators are drugs which relax smooth muscle cells that line blood vessels in the arterial and venous system, thereby increasing the luminal space of blood vessels. As we have learned in previous tutorials, this generates a profound reduction of blood pressure. There are four main classes of vasodilators which we will discuss. These are nitrates, calcium channel blockers, alpha-adrenergic blockers, and beta blockers. Nitrates, such as nitroglycerin, are prodrugs that must be metabolized to nitrite anions and then reduced to nitric oxide. Nitric oxide is a lipophilic secondary messenger that the body endogenously produces in addition to these pharmacological interventions. It is sometimes referred to as endothelial-derived relaxing factor. Because of NO's lipophilicity, it passes freely into smooth muscle cells surrounding blood vessels and activates guanylate cyclase. This enzyme is similar to the adenylate cyclase enzyme we have encountered before. Instead of catalyzing the synthesis of CAMP from ATP, guanylate cyclase catalyzes the conversion of GTP to cGMP. cGMP activates protein kinase G. Protein kinase G has a multitude of functions, but the overall result of its activation is the sequestering of calcium ions in the sarcoplasmic reticulum, as well as efflux from the cytoplasm of the smooth muscle cell. With a reduction of cytoplasmic calcium, myosin light chain kinase can no longer phosphorylate myosin, and less cross-bridge cycling of smooth muscle contraction can occur. This leads to relaxation of blood vessel smooth muscle cells, and hence vasodilation. We will return to nitric oxide when we discuss antiplatelet therapies, since nitric oxide is a potent platelet aggregation inhibitor. Moving along, calcium channel blockers work via a similar mechanism, but they instead block calcium channels in arterial smooth muscle cells. Inhibiting the influx of calcium ions leads to vasodilation in a similar manner as was described through inhibition of the calcium-dependent enzyme myosin light chain kinase. Calcium channel blockers in the dihydropyridine class, such as amlodipine, are more selective for vascular smooth muscle cells. However, non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers in the phenylalkylamine class, such as verapamil, are more selective for the myocardial calcium channels. With less myocardial calcium ion influx, particularly in the sinoatrial node and atrial ventricular node, the rate of contraction of the heart is reduced. With reduced heart contractility, oxygen demand for the myocardium is reduced, and the oxygen deficit, thought to cause angina, diminishes. While different calcium channel blocker classes have different selectivities for the types of calcium channel, whether myocardium or smooth muscle cells in the arteries, they will each have some efficacy in either case, and action on both types of calcium channel will lead to a vasodilatory effect. Calcium channel blockers are a very important class of compounds and have a few different uses, so we will discuss calcium channel blockers in greater detail a bit later. Continuing along, in the previous tutorial, we discussed the use of alpha-1 adrenoceptor agonists for the treatment of hypotension. One class of vasodilators sometimes used is alpha-1 adrenoceptor antagonists. These include drugs such as prazosin. As you might have guessed, the rationale for the function of these drugs is the opposite of the alpha-1 adrenoceptor agonists. The alpha-1 adrenoceptor antagonists inhibit the vasoconstrictive effect that circulating adrenaline has on alpha-1 adrenoceptors, hence reducing smooth muscle contractility and decreasing blood pressure. Finally, beta blockers are a popular term for beta adrenoceptor antagonists. These antagonize adrenaline in the sympathetic nervous system from activating beta adrenoceptors. Normally, adrenaline activates the beta-1 adrenoceptor in the myocardium and increases heart rate through direct action by activating calcium channels, which leads to a greater influx of calcium ions following membrane depolarization, a process known as positive chronotropy. Contractility of the myocytes are also increased, which is called positive inotropy, through its action as a G-alpha-S-coupled GPCR, activating adenylate cyclase and increasing intracellular C-AMP concentrations, which leads to increasing the activity of protein kinase A and phosphorylation of many proteins involved in cardiac muscle contraction. When beta blockers such as atenolol are administered, the circulating adrenaline is antagonized, reducing the heart rate and contractility of the heart, which leads to the decrease of blood pressure. Beta blockers are also used to treat the symptoms of anxiety related to overactivity in the sympathetic nervous system, as well as more complicated psychopharmacological mechanisms that are beyond the scope of this tutorial. And now that we have discussed pharmacological blood pressure modulation, let's move on to discuss anti-arrhythmic drugs.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.